Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. My name is Dr. Seeda Banu and I am Assistant Associate Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Sahiwal Medical College, Sahiwal. Today's lecture is for final year and the topic is ovarian cancers. I will start my lecture with a case history. Mrs. L is a 62 years old woman who presents to the gynecology clinic with non-specific abdominal pain, a change in bowel habit and bloating. Her GP arranged a pelvic ultrasound which found bilateral complex solid cystic pelvic masses, large volume ascites and omental caking. So what is most likely diagnosis in this case? And what are the key points in examination which you would look for? And how would you investigate this patient? And then another question, how would you manage this lady? So at the end of the presentation, you would be able to answer all these questions. And this is an assignment for you. Learning objectives of my presentation are, I will describe incidence of ovarian cancer, classification of ovarian cancer, what are epithelial tumors, and mostly I will discuss epithelial ovarian tumors, their etiology, risk factors, genetic factors, prevention, screening, clinical features, diagnosis and investigations, what is the staging, what is the management, and at the end of the presentation there are three short answer questions related to the subject and also two MCQs, single best, and you have to deposit your assignment on my email address. So there are different kinds of ribbons for different kind of cancers. For ovarian cancer, it's like blue, just blue, and fight like a girl. Ovarian cancer awareness campaigns, they are all over the world. Now the introduction. Ovarian cancer is the second most common gynecological malignancy. You know what is the first most common? It is endometrial cancer, already discussed. But it is the major cause of death from gynecological cancers all over the world. If it presents at an earlier stage, prognosis is good, because most of the time this cancer presents at advanced stage. So the incidence of ovarian cancer, lifetime risk is 1.4%, so little more than 1%.
Rather, it is not effective.
If there are 70 ladies in this room, one is going to get ovarian cancer, and mean age of presentation is 64 years. So it's just like endometrial cancer. The incidence is 10 to 14 per 100,000 women all over the world. 3% of ladies, they present before 35 years of age, and now there are certain new things in the etiology of ovarian cancer. Epithelial ovarian cancers, now it is known that they originate in the fallopian tube, and also there is significant genetic aspect of these cancers. Hereditary cancers, they present at 54 years of age, so 10 years earlier. Then this is the diagram which shows anatomy and histology of the ovaries. It contains surface epithelium, germinal epithelium, then there are primordial follicles, then there are supporting cells of the ova, and then stromal cells. So all these type of ovarian cancers, they arise from different structures of the ovaries. So types of ovarian cancer, just like surface epithelium, epithelial ovarian cancers, they account for 90% of the malignant ovarian cancers. Then germ cell tumors, they originate from germ cells. Cells are destined to form eggs within the ovaries. Then stromal cell cancer begins in the cells that holds the ovaries together and produce female hormones. So these kind of tumors, they produce hormones, and they present with hormonal manifestations of the tumor. So epithelial ovarian tumor, they account for 80% of the ovarian cancers. They can be classified into benign, borderline and malignant. High grade serous carcinomas, they are the most common. Then endometrioid, clear cell, mucinous and low grade serous cancers. Then sex cord stromal tumors, they account for 10% of ovarian tumors, and they include granulosa cell tumors, Sertoli Leydig cell tumors and gynandroblastomas. Granulosa cell tumors, they secrete estrogen, so, and they can also present at earlier age group, like the girls, they can present with precocious puberty. In the reproductive age group, they can present as irregular vaginal bleeding, and postmenopausal ladies, they can present with postmenopausal bleeding. Actually, these are very slow growing malignant ovarian tumors. They take very long to recur. And Sertoli Leydig and gynandroblastoma, these are androgen producing tumors. So if there is a lady presenting with hirsutism of great degree, there is virilization and there is hoarseness of voice, so we must look for underlying androgen secreting ovarian tumors. Then germ cell tumors, they also account 10% of ovarian tumors, and they include dysgerminoma, endodermal sinus tumors, teratoma, choriocarcinoma and mixed tumors. So germ cell tumors, just if we take an early embryo where there is triple layer ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm, there is yolk sac and there is surrounding layer of syncytia and cytotrophoblast. So all these tumors, they rise from all those layers. Then there are certain tumor deposit, distant tumors like colon, stomach and pancreas. They can present as deposits on the ovaries. They are called Krukenberg tumors. Then epithelial tumors, as I already said, benign, borderline or malignant. So borderline variety, they count 10%. They could be serous, mucinous with appendiceal carcinomas, and they can present with pseudomyxoma peritonei. They have some features of malignancy like nuclear pleomorphism and aneuploidy, but they did not invade the basement membranes. The cells did not invade the basement membrane. They can spread to omentum and surrounding pelvic and abdominal structures, but they do not recur usually. Malignant tumors, they account high grade serous in 75% of the cases, and they have certain specific type of structures in them on histology called somoma bodies, which is concentric calcification in the tumor cells. This is characteristic feature of malignant high grade serous tumors. Then there are mucinous tumors. They are large multiloculated tumors and they might be associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei. Then there is another variety, endometrioid tumors. They are associated with endometriosis and they can have existing endometrial cancers in 10% of the cases. Then another variety, clear cell tumors, they are rare. They are also associated with endometriosis and they contain clear cells like renal cells. So the epithelial tumors can take any variety of cell lines: serous, mucinous, endometrioid and clear cells. So serous pathology like tubal pathology, fallopian tubes, and now it is known that they actually arise from the distal ends of the fallopian tube. Mucinous, they look like cervical mucin or appendiceal carcinomas, and endometrioid like endometrial epithelium. So as the ovaries, they arise from the pelvic subplanctic mesoderm, from the and they migrate from there to the pelvis and also Mullerian ducts. So I think they remember their origin, and they can take any form like tubes, like endometrium, like appendix. Then etiology and risk factors. High grade pelvic serous carcinomas, they include all high grade tumors arising from ovary, fallopian tube and peritoneum. And actually these type of cancers, they are very aggressive, and they when they present they involve ovary, fallopian tube and peritoneum. They involve whole of the abdomen, so it is very difficult to distinguish what is the site of origin. And also it doesn't matter, because whatever the origin, they have same prognosis, treatment and behavior. And they are 30% of these high grade pelvic serous cancers, they are associated with BRCA mutations, breast ovarian cancer syndrome mutations. And now it is actually noticed that they arise from distal tubule cells. There is mutation in the secretory cells of distal tubule epithelium, p53 mutation, and precursors at the secretory cells, and they are actually serous tubule intraepithelial carcinomas. And then they involve the whole pelvis, fallopian tube, peritoneum and ovaries. The other variety, endometrioid, mucinous, clear cell, borderline and low grade serous tumors, they have very direct distinct origin from the ovaries. They form inclusion cyst on the surface epithelium, and they arise from those inclusion cysts, or they might arise from endometriosis deposits on the ovaries. It is important to differentiate between high grade pelvic serous and this type of variety, because they have fairly good prognosis. And also mutations, they are different in these kind of tumors. Endometrioid, mucinous, clear cell, they are different from tubal p53 mutation. They are mutations in KRAS, B10, BRAF and Aridia mutations. Most are sporadic, and there is incessant ovulation theory of the mutation, that when there is excessive ovulation induction, there is more injury to the surface epithelium, there is proliferation and malignant transformation. And also if we use increased gonadotropins for ovulation induction, also there is more damage to the surface epithelium. It is also tumorigenesis. So we should be very careful when we give ovulation induction to nulliparous women. If it is given more than 6 months, there are more chances of epithelial ovarian cancer formation. Then what are the risk factors for ovarian cancer? There are increased risk of ovarian cancer in nulliparity, intrauterine contraceptive device, endometriosis, cigarette smoking and obesity, and decreased risk in multiparity, combined pills, because they suppress ovulation. Here there is more ovulation, and this endometriosis is rather associated with endometrioid and clear cell carcinoma. Tubal ligation, salpingectomy and hysterectomy, because it compromises blood supply to the ovaries and tubes. That's why there is reduced risk of ovarian cancer. Now while we are performing hysterectomy, there is recommendation that we should have salpingectomy, even if we are keeping the ovaries, to reduce the risk of ovarian cancer. Then genetic factors, as we inherit money, property from our ancestors, also we inherit hypertension, diabetes and cancers. So 10-15% of women with ovarian cancer, they have hereditary predisposition, like BRCA syndrome, breast ovarian cancer syndrome. BRCA1 mutations, they have more chance of developing ovarian cancer, 80%, than type 2, which have 15% chance. Lynch syndrome, hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer, also they have 10% association with ovarian cancer. Lifetime risk of developing ovarian cancer is 1 in 70, 1.4%. But when there are mutations and one family member affected, then the risk is 1 in 20. So it is 5%, 5 times more. It rises to 40-50% if there are 2 first degree relatives. Hereditary cancer present 10 years before and are associated with breast, colon and rectal cancers. They are mostly adenocarcinomas and improve survival, better response to platinum chemotherapy. So this is BRCA1, BRCA2 mutations, autosomal dominant inheritance pattern, 50% chance of inheritance and lifetime risk of cancer 30 to 70%. Then how can we prevent ovarian cancer? We know the mutations. So women who are positive for these BRCA mutations, they are offered risk reducing prophylactic bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy after completion of the family. Bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy reduces the risk of ovarian cancer in these women by 90% and 50% risk reduction of breast cancer. Chemo prevention, combined oral contraceptive pills, they have 50% reduction of ovarian cancer. And surgical prevention, it is said that hysterectomy, salpingectomy and tubal ligation, it reduces the risk of ovarian cancer. So chemo prevention using combined pills reduces ovarian cancer risk by up to 50% in both BRCA mutation carriers and women at average risk of ovarian cancer. Screening. Transvaginal ultrasound and CA1 to 5 levels have not shown to improve survival, and if screening is not effective in case of ovarian cancer. There is one trial, UK TOX trial, randomized control trial going on. The results are awaited. The role of screening in women of average lifetime risk of ovarian cancer remains unclear, because most of the ladies, even if who have BRCA mutation carriers, they develop rapidly and they are at an advanced stage before they can be picked up by screening. Then what are the clinical features of ovarian cancer? They are non-specific and vague. There is increased abdominal girth and bloating, persistent pelvic and abdominal pain, difficulty in eating and feeling full quickly. There is change in the bowel habits, uni symptoms, backache, irregular bleeding and fatigue. Feeling the need to urinate, trouble eating, pelvic abdominal pain, then bloating. So all non-specific symptoms, mostly related to GIT. Then clinical features regarding examination. Pelvic and abdominal examination may reveal a fixed hard mass arising from the pelvis. Of course, if it is at advanced stage, earlier stage, we cannot pick. Differential diagnosis is tube ovarian abscess, endometriomas or fibroids. Mass with ascites diagnosis is likely ovarian cancer. If adnexal masses are present in premenopausal women, they are cancers in less than 20% of the ladies. And if it is present in postmenopausal women, the chance of having an adnexal mass to be malignant raises to 50%. Chest examination is performed for pleural effusion. There is Tony Dahl percussion note on pleural effusion if it is present. It is present in advanced stage ovarian cancer or it could be present in association with ascites. Then neck and groin lymph nodes, they are palpated. It is part of examination in a patient with ovarian cancer, because even early stage patients, they have lymph nodes positive in 25% of the cases. Then how can we diagnose and investigate? Transvaginal ultrasound is an excellent tool for characterizing an ovarian mass in terms of size, consistency, presence of solid elements, bilaterality, presence of ascites and extra ovarian disease or mental mets. Actually, if the cancer is advanced, then abdominal scan is also a good option for diagnosis of all these things. Then tumor markers, they are done serum tumor markers, carcinoembryonic antigen, CA1 to 5 level. This is a glycoprotein. It is non-specific, but it is elevated in 80% of epithelial ovarian cancers. After getting ultrasound and tumor markers, we calculate the risk of malignancy index. And this is used to triage the ovarian tumor into low grade, intermediate or high grade. Excuse me. And if patient falls in intermediate or high grade, And if patient falls in intermediate or high risk category, then CT scan and MRI of the pelvis is performed. CT scan actually tells us for the assessment of extra pelvic disease and for staging, and MRI helps to define tissue planes and operability. Other investigations which are required as a preoperative workup, they include chest X-ray, ECG, complete blood count, urine and electrolytes, and liver function tests. Ascites and pleural effusion, they can be tapped to get examination of the fluid for symptomatic relief and or for the diagnosis. A sample of the fluid removed is sent for cytological assessment if diagnosis is uncertain or if primary chemotherapy is being considered. For example, for advanced stage or patient is not fit or does not want to undergo surgery, a biopsy is needed before treatment can be given. This is performed laparoscopically or radiologically. Usually the omentum is a good site for biopsy. Next comes the tumor markers in case of ovarian masses. CA125, this is raised in epithelial ovarian cancer, and this is used for diagnosis and for follow-up. CEA and also CA199, this is for mucinous ovarian cancer, again for diagnosis and follow-up. It is used preoperative and also for follow-up. HCD, human chorionic gonadotropin hormone, embryonal carcinoma or choriocarcinoma, again preoperative workup and for follow-up. Inhibin A or B granulosa cell tumors, they release inhibin A or B, also release estrogen, and the side effects can be precocious puberty, postmenopausal bleeding or irregular vaginal bleeding in granulosa cell tumors. Then lactate dehydrogenase, this is released by dysgerminoma and tumor marker for dysgerminoma. Alpha fetoprotein, they are released by endodermal tumors or embryonal carcinoma. Actually, immature teratomas and embryonal carcinoma, they can be mixed type of germ cell tumors. Then there are other conditions in which cancer antigen CA125 is raised. In breast cancer, pancreatic, colon, lung and endometrial cancer, this is raised, and certain non-cancerous conditions like endometriosis, fibroids, PID, hepatitis, pregnancy, menses, peritonitis and recent abdominal surgery also raised in these kind of conditions. CA125 is present in greater concentrations in ovarian tumor cells than in any other cells of the body. This is how we calculate risk of malignancy index. This is according to RCOG Green Top guidelines of UK, and mu ultrasound findings, u ultrasound findings, m for score premenopause, this is 1, and in case of postmenopause 3, and then CA125 level. Normal level is 35, less than 35, more than that is abnormal. And here we multiply all these elements, and if risk is less than 25, low risk, 25 to 250 moderate risk, and 250 more than this is high risk. Then staging of ovarian cancer. Ovarian cancer staging is based upon clinicopathological assessment, and like other gynecological cancers, uses the FIGO staging system. Overall, 25% of the patient present with stage 1 disease, 10% with stage 2, 50% stage 3, and 15% stage 4 disease. Metastatic spread is by direct spread to peritoneum and other organs, and by lymphatic spread to pelvic and periaortic nodes. A high percentage of women, they present with advanced stage where they have evidence of peritoneal disease on diaphragmatic peritoneum. Women with early ovarian disease stage 1 or 2 have up to 20% metastatic spread to lymph nodes, and this rises to 60% in advanced stage disease. Then stages of the ovary. Healthy ovaries, cancer is confined to one or both ovaries. Cancer spread within the pelvic region. Then stage 3, cancer spreads to other body parts within the abdomen. Then stage 4, cancer spreads beyond the abdomen to other body parts. Then more detailed stage 1, tumor limited to ovaries, one A to one ovary, one B to both ovaries, but the tumor surface is intact, there is no ascites, positive for cytology, and tumor is not present on the surface of the ovaries. If in 1C with ascites, with surface on tumor on the surface of the ovary, and there's breach in the tumor surface. Stage 2 involves one or both ovaries with pelvic involvement. 2A extension implants the uterus fallopian tube, but no ascites, positive for cytology. And 2B, 2C, here other pelvic organs along with tumor present on the surface, and there is ascites, positive for cytology. Then stage 3, spread to abdomen. 3A microscopic spread, 3B macroscopic, but the tumor deposit less than 2 cm, 3C abdominal implants more than 2 cm, and or retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. Stage 4, there are distant metastases including mets in the liver parenchyma. Already mentioned, then management of these patients. Surgery is the mainstay of treatment. Provided the patient is fit to undergo anesthesia, surgery remains necessary for diagnosis, staging, and treatment of epithelial ovarian tumors. If the patient is at high risk of ovarian cancer, the surgery should only be performed by a gynecological oncologist, as this has been shown to improve the outcome. The objective of surgery is to stage the disease and accurately to remove all visible tumor. This is vitally important in ovarian cancer, as many studies indicate that the most important prognostic factor is no residual disease following laparotomy. Aim of the disease is complete optimal cytoreduction, where 1 cm of the residual macroscopic disease is left behind or less than that. Tumor deposits in the bowel, spleen, peritoneal surface and diaphragm are amenable to resection, while disease involving porta, hepatis and bowel mesentery, it is inoperable. It is not amenable to treat. Then staging laparotomy is done by a vertical incision in the abdomen, so that we have gained access to all areas of the abdomen. Then ascites and peritoneal washings are sampled for cytological assessment. Total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy and omentectomy is performed. Further debulking from bowel and peritoneum is required, and lymph node dissection and removal is important part of the surgery, particularly in early stage where the studies have found occult metastasis. This is lymph node resection, not dissection. Then in addition to this advanced surgery, there is fertility sparing surgery in young patients who have early stage disease and who wish to preserve their fertility. Also, fertility sparing surgery is performed in borderline ovarian tumors. What we do, unilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, omentectomy, peritoneal biopsies and pelvic or para-aortic lymph node resection along with endometrial biopsy. Why endometrial biopsy? Because 10% of the endometrioid cancers, they have associated endometrioid carcinoma of the endometrium. So we don't want to leave endometrial carcinoma behind. Then there is interval surgery after primary chemotherapy. If the patient is unfit or unwilling for surgery, complete debulking is impossible, then first we give 6 cycles of chemotherapy 3 weeks apart, and then afterwards we perform surgery. It reduces perioperative morbidity, but it does not influence the survival of the patient. Then second look surgery, it planned laparotomy at the end of chemotherapy, it has got no survival benefits, so it's not recommended. One thing is very important in all type of cancers, and especially ovarian cancer. Following surgery, all patients with diagnosis of epithelial ovarian cancer are discussed in gyne-oncology multidisciplinary meeting. History, surgical management and histology are reviewed by gyne-oncologist, oncologist, radiologist, pathologist and nursing staff, and then a conclusion, a plan is made. If stage 1A, 1B and histologically low grade tumor, chemotherapy may not be required. If it is 1C, or more than one C advanced stage, then chemotherapy is usually recommended. Now, what is the chemotherapy given in these type of patients? Primary chemotherapy can be given as a primary treatment or as an adjunct following surgery or for the relapse of the disease. The aim of chemotherapy is to prolong clinical remission and survival of the patient, or it is sometimes given for palliative purposes. First line treatment is usually a combination of a platinum compound with paclitaxel. Most regimes are given on an outpatient basis 3 weeks apart for 6 cycles. Platinum compounds are the most effective chemotherapeutic agents in ovarian cancer. They are heavy metal agents that cause cross linkage of deoxyribonucleic acid strands, thus arresting cell replication. Carboplatin is not the main platinum compound used. It is less renal toxic and causes less nausea than cisplatin, but it is equally as effective. Paclitaxel is derived from bark of a Pacific yew tree and works by causing microtubular damage to the cell. This prevents replication and cell division. It is associated with anaphylactic reaction, so prophylactic steroids are given, and it is associated with peripheral neuropathy, neutropenia, myalgia, which is dose dependent. And also one important side effect is whole body alopecia, total loss of whole body hair irrespective of the dose. Then target therapies: bevacizumab, a monoclonal antibody against vascular endothelial growth factor receptors. It inhibits angiogenesis, but it is very costly, and it is associated with side effects like hypertension, delayed wound healing, GI perforation, and arterial thromboembolic events. So this is not routinely prescribed as first line drug for advanced ovarian cancer on its due to cost issue. However, it is available for the treatment of recurrent disease, and it is given along with carboplatin and paclitaxel. Following completion of chemotherapy, CT scan is performed to assess response to the treatment. This can be used for comparison in the future if there is clinical or biochemical evidence of the recurrence. Follow-up of the patients include clinical examination and CA125 measurements. Studies have shown that levels of CA125 level they start rising before clinical evidence of the disease, so it is used in monitoring. When disease recurs, treatment is largely palliative. If duration of remission is more than 6 months after chemotherapy, we might use carboplatin again. Otherwise, Taxol, topotecan, or liposomal doxorubicin is used. Prognosis depends upon the stage of the disease, volume of the residual disease, post-surgery, histological type and grade of the tumor, and also age at presentation. Ovarian cancer survival rate: in stage 1, this is 80 to 90%, 5-year survival. Stage 2, 65 to 70%, stage 3, 30 to 50%, stage 4, 15%. What we have learned from this lecture: ovarian cancer, it presents usually at an advanced stage. There is late presentation because the symptoms are non-specific. Screening is not effective using tumor markers and transvaginal ultrasound. Even it is not effective in BRCA mutation positive carriers, and actually uncertain in case of general population. Treatment is based upon removing all tumors surgically combined with platinum-based chemotherapy. Prognosis is stage dependent. Stage 1 has very excellent survival rate of 80 to 90%. Stage 3 is distal, like 30%. 6-chord stromal tumors usually present with endocrine effects, estrogen from granulosa cell tumors, and androgen from Sertoli-Leydig or gynandroblastomas. Germ cell tumors, they affect young women and are cured by fertility sparing surgery. Now the case history. Again, 62-year-old woman who presents to the gynec clinic with non-specific abdominal pain, a change in bowel habit and bloating. Her GP arranged the pelvic ultrasound. There's bilateral complex solid mass, large volume ascites and a mental caking. So now, what is the most likely diagnosis? I'm sure now all of you must be knowing what is the diagnosis. And the other question is, what are the key points which you would look for in examination? And how would you investigate this patient as for diagnostic purpose and for preoperative workup, both? Number three, how would you treat this lady? Then single best answer questions, MCQ. A 34-year-old woman attends gynecology clinic because she has tested positive for BRCA1 mutation. She wishes to lower her risk of ovarian cancer as much as possible. She is otherwise fit and well with no past medical history of note. Cervical smear is normal. What surgery would you recommend in this patient? A. Bilateral oophorectomy. B. Bilateral salpingectomy with delayed oophorectomy. C. Bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. D. Subtotal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. E. Total abdominal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. Choose best. Then another MCQ. A 50-year-old woman presents with large pelvic abdominal mass to Zephy sternum. On scan it shows solid cystic components but no free fluid. CA1 to 5 is 430 units. She is asymptomatic. How would you manage this patient? A. Laparoscopic ovarian cystectomy. B. Laparotomy. THPSO placentectomy. Pelvic and periotic lymph node sampling and debulking of the tumor deposits. C. Repeat scan in CA1 to 5 level after 3 months to see the change, and 6 cycles of chemotherapy with carboplatin and paclitaxel and repeat scan, and E. Ultrasound guided cyst fluid aspiration and cytological assessment. So choose best. Please answer all these questions and email me. I will WhatsApp you my email address in the group. Thank you very much. If you have any queries or any questions, also you can post in the group. Thank you very much.